time. Yes, and today's story is entitled, The Man from Ur. The Man from Ur. Yes. Have you ever heard of Ur? Do you know where Ur is? Ur is present day Iraq or Iran. It is located in the Middle East. The country Ur no longer exists. New civilizations have moved into that area and they now live there. But during Bible times, there was a place called Ur. Picture, if you can, what happened after the work of the Tower of Babel ceased. Yes, the Tower of Babel. Have you been told about that story? Yes. 50 years, 100 years passed by. The massive building still stands on the plain of Shinar, gaunt and unfinished. Passersbyers point to it in fear as something cursed of God. They remember that in some mysterious way, the language of all the builders, that means everybody that was up there, their language was changed. They were confused, so they fell among themselves, then scattered all over the earth. They were unable to talk to one another. God confound their language. They were trying to build a tower all the way to heaven, thinking that if God decided to destroy the world, they would have a safe haven in this tower. But God did not allow the tower to exist. He scattered everyone all over the earth. Because of the scattering that God had did, we have people now today all over the world. God did this as he scattered them from one place to the other in various places we call Europe, India, China, Siberia, the United States, North America, South America. God moved people from one place to the other because of the Babel Tower. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower and the people were building. The Lord said, as if one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this. Then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Genesis 11:5-6. Villages and towns and cities spring up all over the industrialized world. Precious stone, metals buried by the flood are being discovered here and there, all over the place, all over the globe. Goldsmiths are busy making beautiful ornaments, some of which can be seen today in museums. Boat builders are busy on the river Euphrates and the Persian Gulf looking for treasures. The first sailors are setting forth to explore the ocean and lands beyond. Unfortunately, with all this activity and growing prosperity, the people are again turning away from God. Some have even started to make idols and worship them. That means they are making things, creating things, and then calling them gods. Noah, in his old age as a man, understood what God would have him to do. Noah, in his old age, nearly 99 years old, his words do not carry the weight they once did. He continues to tell his thrilling story about the wonderful world he knew before the flood and about what happened to it because of the wickedness of the people. But already it has become too many, nothing but a fairy tale. People discounted Noah's adventures and relationship with God. People began to believe that the story was just a story, that the flood did not happen. Mostly, if not at all, are seeking their own pleasures and profits, caring less and less for the things of God as they think more and more about themselves. Do you think more about yourself than God? God, looking down upon the scene, is saddened, for he sees that man has not learned his lesson, as it's fast becoming as sinful as he was before the judgment of the flood. Perhaps the thought came to God just then that it might have been better if Noah had perished with the rest, and so have saved all this trouble and sorrow. God was beginning to think maybe everyone, including Noah and his family, should have been destroyed. But that was impossible, for that had not God promised Adam in the Garden of Eden that one day he would soon restore everything that was lost on the day of the first sin? Had he not said that seed of the woman would bruise the serpent's head? Therefore, her seed must not perish till the victory shall be won. When God makes a promise, he keeps it. Yes, do you make promises? Do you keep your promises? Well, God keeps all his promises. Not one does God let go unkept. Unlike us, God always keeps his promise. He never goes back on it. And when he set himself to carry out some purpose, nothing can stand in his way. That is why he watched over the ark with such infinite care as it was tossed to and fro all around the mountains and the floods and the waves. He had no intention of giving Satan the satisfaction of seeing the last remnants of the race blotted out by the raging water. And that's why 350 years later, an all-seeing eye turned one day toward a certain city known in those far-off days as Ur of Chaldea. God focused his eyes on that. In this city was a boy upon whom God had set his heart, a good lad and godly. Someone, perhaps his mother, had told him the marvelous story of creation and of God's wonderful love for his earthly children, whom he had placed in the beautiful Eden home in the long ago, and of all the joy and glory that was there. As they walked and talked with God, he had heard too how many sin had been done away with. And after sin had spoiled everything, God had come near and tender, giving forgiveness to save his beloved creatures from the full consequences of disobedience. Yes, God made a plan, and God keeps his promises. And as the dear old story had been told and retold to him from a childhood by Noah himself, he passed on to his children, Shem, Ham, Japheth. Abraham had given his heart to God and made the great decision to serve him all his days. Yes, Abraham had made a decision based on the stories he had been told that he would serve God. God had a purpose for Abraham. It wasn't easy for Abraham to do right, for most of the people in the city had already turned to idolatry. Indeed, his own father had fallen to wicked ways. So Abraham had to take a stand for God by himself, right there in his own home. Abraham took a stand for God. But God was watching him, just as he watches every boy and girl today. And he was glad to see that Abraham was willing to take a stand for him. For God said, I will take that boy and use him in a wonderful way in carrying out my great purpose for the good of man. But first, I must take him away from this evil surrounding. So one day, when Abraham was grown to manhood, his heart still set on following the Lord, he heard a voice speaking to him. He knew that voice was the voice of God. God still speaks to us today. Are we listening to what God has to tell us? Yes, God spoke, and Abraham knew it was the voice of God. Perhaps it was while he was at evening prayer, or at night while looking up at the stars, marveling at the mighty handiwork of God. Wherever it was, in the sacred stillness of that moment, God said, get thee out of this country, and from there I will show thee, and I will make thee a great nation. I will make thee, bless thee, and make thy name great. Thou shalt be blessed, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curse thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Yes, God made a promise. Genesis 12, verses 1 through 3. Now the Lord has said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from the father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be blessed. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. All the families received a blessing because of Noah's faithfulness to follow God. Chosen for greatness. You see, in order for a caterpillar to emerge into a butterfly, that means a caterpillar changing into a butterfly, the promise, it first enters into the cocoon, the process. We want the promise, salvation from all, Romans 10, 13, of God without getting through the process. Salvation for all, at NRS request, preparation, Luke 15, 11, 32, the fathers met the son halfway. We want God to add to the church. We don't want to meet people halfway. We want to share all we know about Jesus, because it makes us more comfortable when we do that. The father fixes up what he already has for the son. Preparation requires us to fix up what God has already given us. That caterpillar has to go through the process of the cocoon to become a butterfly. We too must go through the process, allowing God to help us grow in Him, that we can be a blessing to someone else. That is what God would have us to do, that process. So Abraham and his family gathered their things and left based on what God had told them. It was a great crisis in Abraham's life and in the history of the world. For a moment, all the future hung in his decision. Would he go or would he stay? He was comfortable at home. Life was easy. All his friends and family were there. He was familiar with the town. To leave all this was to court danger and maybe poverty and disaster. Certainly, it would be a venture into the unknown with no certain outcome. But what did he do? Yes, according to the record, he did not hesitate, not even for a moment. He took God at his word and obeyed him at once. God loved him for his obedience and doing this. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him. The people of Ur must have wondered what was happening as they noticed all the bustling and commotion around Abraham's house. And more so when they saw the whole family gather up everything and leave. Despite his age, despite the differences, despite what his friends were thinking and what everybody was saying, Abraham said it was because he had been called of God to go out into a new country. They could not understand God's call. But Abraham was called by God to leave Ur. How could that be? It didn't seem reasonable to them that anyone be so foolish to leave a thriving city that they had everything like Ur and go out not knowing where they were going. But Abraham understood. He knew what he was doing. God had spoken, and that was enough. Yet how little he knew of what was before him or of all that God had in mind to accomplish through his life for the blessing of mankind. When God said to him, "In thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. In thee shall all the families of the earth shall be blessed." Abraham, no doubt, wondered how such a thing could be, for the only families he knew just then were those around his home and possibly a few others. He must have asked himself, how could this ever be a blessing to them? But before the mind of God spread the whole picture of history to be, Abraham became the father of the faithful. The father of the faithful. The head of a great line of godly men through whom at last our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, would come and fulfill the promise of redemption made to Adam in the Garden of Eden. Still further ahead, God saw the glorious day when men and women, children from every nation under heaven, would share in the final victory of what God's special blessing would be to them. Thus, it was always when God calls us to do something for Him, He may not make it fully understandable. He has in His mind for us, but we may be sure that it is always something good that God has in store for us when God calls us. Knowing this, let us do as Abraham did. Trust him, obey him, follow him where he asks. When God is calling you, will you answer? Can you hear God's voice calling you? See, he created you. He has chosen you. God is calling you. Created, chosen, and called. God always leads us to where we need to be and not where we want to be. Why? Because he created us, chosen us, and is calling us. And so we are to follow God's lead where he called. I have decided to follow Jesus. What about you? Have you made that decision to follow Jesus? It's easy. We simply must trust and obey. Trust and obey in God.